Hello there you guys, welcome to another of my videos. Going to be giving you my predictions for our game against Granada in the Europa League quarter-final first leg. So score prediction, I'm going to go with 2-1 to Manchester United. The goal scorers, I'm going to go with Bruno Fernandes and Edison Cavani for us. And Granada, I'm going to go with Soldado. I've already given you my starting 11 prediction. This is a massive game for Manchester United. The Europa League is our only chance of any silverware this season. Solskjaer needs to win a trophy at Manchester United because that would mark progress. He's not yet won a trophy as Manchester United manager, and he's been Man United manager over 2 years, and we haven't won a trophy since 2017. So if we didn't win the Europa League this season, that'd be exactly 4 years without a trophy. But if we fail to win the Europa League, Solskjaer is not getting sacked. So I can assure he will be Manchester United manager in the summer transfer window, and he'll be Man United manager next season. I did say he does deserve another season because progress has been made in certain aspects. We got to the Europa League semi-finals last season. We lost 2-1 to Sevilla. And we won the Europa League back in 2017 under the Jose Mourinho era. We beat Ajax in the final 2-0. We progressed to the Europa League quarter-finals by beating Real Sociedad in the round of 32. And we beat AC Milan in the round of 16. We're coming into this game on the back of a 2-1 win against Brighton. Reflecting on that 2-1 win against Brighton, I can assure now we will finish in the top 4. There's a very good chance that we'll finish second this season. If we don't finish second, we'll finish third. It was a poor performance by Manchester United against Brighton in the first half, but I thought in the second half we improved. The goals obviously was from Danny Welbeck for Brighton. And Wan-Bissaka was accountable for Danny Welbeck's goal because Wan-Bissaka lost him completely. And our goals came from Marcus Rashford, lovely side-footed finish. And the other goal came from Mason Greenwood. Before the Leicester game in the FA Cup quarter-final, we was 14 games unbeaten. Now, obviously, we do have some injuries. Marcus Rashford's injured. He came off injured against Brighton. He didn't look fully fit anyway. Rashford has become injury prone because he's sustained a few injuries now at Manchester United. I presume Solskjaer will provide us with an update on Marcus Rashford in his press conference today. Anthony Martial, he's out with injury. Solskjaer said it's likely Martial will be out for the remainder of the season. Eric Bailly's not available because he's got COVID. Phil Jones and Juan Mata are still out, but Jones and Mata don't get in our team anyway. Now, Granada, they're currently sitting ninth in La Liga. Their current manager is Diego Martinez. Granada recently lost 3-0 to Villarreal. They progressed to the Europa League quarterfinals by beating Napoli in the round of 32 and they beat Mulder in the round of 16. Mulder is Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's former club. I think this will be the first ever time we'll be playing Granada. Now, Granada's key players are Soldado, George Molina. George Molina and Soldado are Granada's joint top goal scorers. Luis Suarez, he's one of their key players as well. They've got Yangel Herrera. Granada have got some injuries. Suarez is out with injury. I think he's a doubt for the first leg. Miller, he's also out with injury. Alberto Soro's out with injury. Charis is out with injury. Nedar Lozano's out with injury. Dimitar Falque is out with injury. And Pepe Sanchez is doubtful. The second leg against Granada is next week. That is at Old Trafford because the first leg is at Granada. We've got a massive game at the weekend against Tottenham. Now, this year's summer transfer window is huge for Manchester United and Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. Recent reports said that Manchester United will spend big in the summer transfer window, but Solskjaer wants to keep transfer dealings quiet. I'm expecting us to make around 3 or 4 signings in the summer transfer window, and I've already identified the weaknesses in the squad. I think we need a striker, we need a right winger, we need a defensive midfielder, and we also need a centre half. I reckon Solskjaer needs around £200 million if he's to get the players he wants to recommend in. He said earlier on this season that our transfer budget had been revealed. It was £80 million. A lot of United fans were shocked in that aspect because we know £80 million is nowhere near enough for us to get the players we want to recommend in. Solskjaer did warn earlier on this season that we may not do business as usual due to the pandemic. But he said he's interested in bringing in players that will be a perfect fit for the club. Now, I'm expecting Solskjaer to get the backing he deserves in the summer transfer window because obviously we've got John Murtough. He's our director of football and the club made the right decision by getting a director of football in because I did mention that's one of the structural changes that we needed. Plus, John Murtough knows the club through thick and thin. He's been at Man United since 2014 and he's our first ever director of football, by the way. And obviously we've got Darren Fletcher, who's our technical director, and he also knows the club through thick and thin because he endured 2 decades as a player for Manchester United. And Solskjaer's already had discussions with our recruitment team about our transfer targets and our transfer plans for the summer in general. Woodward obviously believes that Solskjaer is the right man to lead the club forward. He released a statement earlier on this season saying that the progress by Solskjaer and the players this season is clear. So in that aspect, Woodward is backing him. And in general, Woodward has come out several times to show his support for Ole, even when we're enduring them really bad periods. Like I've mentioned before, our board have got a soft stance on Solskjaer with him being a club legend. And the main explanation he's still Manchester United manager is because he's a club legend. That's what saved him, I'd say. Disregarding being a club legend, I can almost assure he wouldn't have been Manchester United manager now. So far, Solskjaer spent almost £300 million at Manchester United and he's endured four transfer windows as permanent Man United manager so far. But yeah, there's a lot of players that we are looking at. Now, I've already given you the news on Jadon Sancho. Fabrizio Romano has explained the hold-up in Jadon Sancho to Manchester United. Borussia Dortmund have admitted they will sell Jadon Sancho for the right price in the summer. We'll have to submit an exceptional offer to sign Sancho, one Dortmund. So reflecting on that, Sancho to Man United is off. Now, we actually believe we can get Jadon Sancho for a cut price fee of £50 million. Said earlier on this season, was preparing to put a £50 million bid in. But it did say earlier on this season that we paused our transfer pursuit of Sancho due to the progress of Mason Greenwood. By the way, Sancho's fuming with Dortmund's disallowed goal in their 2-1 defeat to Man City in the Champions League yesterday. Earlier on this season, Sancho did make an admission saying that he has endured a difficult season at Dortmund, but he said he was happy to be back among the goals. Borussia Dortmund's CEO did say earlier on this season that Sancho, Haaland and more Dortmund stars could be sold to avoid financial crisis. Now, last summer, Jadon Sancho was our number one priority target. But the main explanation we didn't get him is because Borussia Dortmund's valuation was £108 million and we was reluctant to meet their valuation. But Sancho to Man United last summer was very close because it said that the personal terms had been agreed, the agent fees had been agreed and even a contract had been agreed. But we couldn't come to an agreement on an actual fee, so that's what was the stumbling block. Dortmund said to us last summer that we had until the 10th of August to sign Sancho. We missed out on that deadline, so Sancho remained at Dortmund. Fabrizio Romano has spoken a lot about the Sancho saga, and so too has Bild's Christian Falk. Analysing the vast majority of Sancho's career at Dortmund, he's been very consistent. This is his fourth season with them now. Dortmund got him for next to nothing. They only paid £8 million for him from Man City in 2017. And he's got a contract with Dortmund until 2023. And we was willing to offer him that number 7 shirt. Now, you know the news on Erling Haaland. It looks like Erling Haaland to Manchester United is also off, as well as Sancho. Because the Athletic said yesterday that we have cooled our interest in Erling Haaland because we are prioritising two deals. It says we want a right winger and a centre-half instead of Haaland. Now, it recently said that we declined to meet Erling Haaland's agent Mino Raiola over discussing a possible deal for Haaland. Not so long ago, Erling Haaland's agent and his father flown to England for talks with several Premier League clubs. Haaland and his agent have also been to Barcelona for talks and they've also been to Real Madrid for talks. Haaland did say not so long ago that he thinks Barcelona love him. He said a few weeks ago that Dortmund had revealed their asking price and it was £154 million. Dortmund are going to find it extremely difficult if they are demanding that much. But Erling Haaland is likely to leave Dortmund, especially if Dortmund fail to qualify for the Champions League. Alf Inge Haaland, Erling Haaland's father, he's spoken a lot about his son's transfer links to Man United. And he's spoken about his son's career and his prospects. Solskjaer did say in his press conference prior to the Brighton game that he played down talk of Man United chasing Haaland. He said he'll make his own mind up. Now, quite a few weeks ago now, it said Solskjaer kept calling Haaland to persuade him to join Manchester United, because he said earlier on this season, Ollie, that he was keeping in touch with the player and he's following his progress. It'd be great to see Solskjaer reunite with him. Solskjaer gave Erling Haaland his debut at Molde at just the age of 16. And back in December 2019, Solskjaer and Woodward went to Norway to meet up with Haaland to negotiate a possible move to Man United. Haaland has a £68 million release clause, but it doesn't become active until next year. Haaland has been at Dortmund around 15-16 months now. He's got a contract with them till 2024, and Dortmund paid around £17 million, which is cheap. But if Haaland comes to the Premier League, I can assure he will exceed expectations. He'll replicate what he's been doing at Borussia Dortmund. But he may not come to the Premier League. You know, he may go to Spain to either Barcelona or Real Madrid. There's a slight chance he'll stay at Dortmund potentially past the summer. But I don't think he'll be there long term. There was narratives coming out the other week saying that Haaland was demanding £600,000 a week from his next club. Now, there's obviously still a lot of narratives coming out regarding Ousmane Dembele from Barcelona. Now, Spanish outlet Sport said not so long ago that we've increased our interest in Ousmane Dembele, and we have been monitoring his displays this season, and we are preparing a bid, and we have been in discussions with his representatives. Now, don't forget, last year we wanted to get Ousmane Dembele on loan with the option to buy, but obviously that didn't materialise. Fabrizio Romano did say that Ousmane Dembele is set to hold talks with Barcelona over a new contract. He's been linked to Liverpool before. Ousmane Dembele has been at Barcelona now for quite a few years. He's got like 15 months left on his current contract. Barcelona got him in a deal worth around £135 million. Barcelona paid £97 million, I think, up front. He's injury prone, Ousmane Dembele. Sustained quite a few injuries at Barcelona. Before he was at Barcelona, he was at Dortmund. I thought he was good at Dortmund. And before Dortmund, he was at Rennes, and he was quite good at Rennes. There's been good news coming out regarding Raphael Varane in recent weeks. It says that Raphael Varane's contract talks with Real Madrid have stalled. And the Spanish newspaper ABC said, I think the other week, that Real Madrid have set an asking price of £51 million for Rafael Varane, and £51 million is very cheap for a player of his calibre. He'd go very well alongside Maguire in our back line. He said earlier on this season, though, that Real Madrid are prepared to sell him on one condition: he must inform Real Madrid on his decision to leave. Varane has been at Real Madrid almost 10 years now, is it? He's made over 300 appearances and he's won 18 major honours. Madrid paid just €10 million for him from Lens back in 2011, but there's been quite a few centre-halves on our agenda. But yeah, in the summer transfer window, we're going to focus on the incomings and the outgoings. We're going to get rid of quite a few players in the summer transfer window, so reflecting on that will generate money and it'll help us with our rebuilding process. Now, it looks like De Gea, he's going to be leaving Man United in the summer transfer window, because it says that David De Gea has made his transfer decision. He's preparing to leave. Apparently, we're set to pay off his huge contract. And we've set the price for De Gea. We want £50 million. Now, there's three clubs that are chasing him. That's Atletico Madrid, Real Madrid and PSG. I did mention that there's a good chance he'll go back to Spain. De Gea has 2 years left on his current contract at Man United and he's on £375,000 a week, which is a substantial amount. Some United fans may think it's a mistake letting De Gea go, but I reckon he's had his years now at Manchester United. He's been at the club almost 10 years. He's been with us since the Ferguson era. You know, he's won everything domestically at the football club. A few years ago, De Gea was regarded as the best goalkeeper in the world, but in the last couple of years, he's become a liability, reflecting on the calamitous mistakes he's made. De Gea has made over 500 appearances in all competitions. I think Henderson's now our number one anyway, because Henderson has started our last 7 games in a row. And it's the right decision to put Henderson as number one, because I did say he's reliable enough to be our number one. And obviously, if De Gea leaves, then he'll certainly be our number one. Phil Jones, I'm also expecting him to leave because he doesn't get in our 11. And Jones has been out of injury for over a year and he's always been inconsistent. Jones is the only outfield player that's still here from the Ferguson era. And this is his 10th season at Manchester United, so he's been a long servant. Axel Tuanzebe, could we offload him because he doesn't get in our 11? Eric Bay, could we offload him? Because he's actually lost his place in the team. I'd love us to keep Bay potentially past the summer, because he is a good centre-half. My only element of concern about Eric Bay is too injury-prone, so in that aspect he's a liability. Now, it recently said we want £17 million to let Bay leave for Inter Milan. It says not so long ago, contract talks for Eric Bay are on hold until he has assurances over his playing time. We seem to prefer Lindelof over Eric Bay for some reason. The other week it said that Bay apologised to Ole Gunnar Solskjaer and Man United for his disrespectful behaviour. Because it said Bay was furious with Ole because he felt disrespected and not wanted at the club. And Bay said we're only offering him a new contract to simply increase his asking price. Bay's got like 15 months left on his current contract. We got him from Villarreal back in 2016. We paid £30 million for him. Paul Pogba, we could sell him in the summer transfer window, but there's also a chance he'll stay potentially past the summer. Paul Pogba has had a long-running transfer saga. He's been linked with a move to Real Madrid and PSG before, and he's been relentlessly linked with a return to Juventus. I said there's a good chance he'll go back to Juventus because he did endure 4 very good years with them before he rejoined Manchester United. Now, it says obviously Juventus have been keen on a swap deal for Pogba. Not so long ago, it said Juventus willing to offer as Paulo Dybala in exchange for Pogba. And it said he was willing to offload Adrian Rabiot and Aaron Ramsey to afford Pogba. Romano said that Juventus have refused to give up on re-signing Pogba. But recently, it's come out and said that Juventus have told his agent Mino Raiola they cannot afford Paul Pogba. So, reflecting on that, it says Paul Pogba could be set to sign a new contract at Manchester United. Ole Gunnar Solskjaer did actually say that Paul Pogba's future lies at Old Trafford. But the other week, it said that Pogba still wants to quit Man United. He's rejected a new contract. Di Marzio come out and said that Pogba's got no intentions of extending his Man United contract, and he did say his preferred destination is Juventus. But I'd like him to stay potentially past the summer, because in recent months we've been getting the best out of Paul Pogba, and he brings creativity to the team. Disregarding Pogba, we lack that creativity and we are far too defensive. I like Paul Pogba in more of an advanced role because that's where he's more effective. I'm not really that keen on him in a deeper role. He started in a deeper role against Brighton. That game against Brighton was his first start in the Premier League for over 2 months, because he was out with a thigh injury for a while. At the first part of this season, he had an ankle injury. And for the vast majority of last season, he was out with an ankle injury. Pogba's under contract with Man United till June 2022. Because earlier on this season, we triggered that 1 year extension on his contract. If he stays potentially past the summer, he could leave on the... There's a good chance he'll leave on a free next year, unless he signs a new contract. Donny van de Beek, there's also a good chance that we'll offload him. I think we do need to offload him. The main explanation is because he's not getting enough opportunities at Manchester United. Now, it has said that we are considering a Donny van de Beek swap deal. And Two or Sports said that we're willing to offer Donny van de Beek to Juventus in exchange for Adrian Rabiot. Mark Hughes was talking about Donny van de Beek not so long ago, and he said he feels lost at Manchester United and he's edging closer to a Man United exit. Now, it did say that Donny van de Beek feels loved at Man United. That's according to Ronald de Boer, despite his lack of game time. Said earlier on this season, though, that Donny van de Beek wanted showdown talks with Ed Woodward over his future, because it said he wanted to leave Man United after one season due to his lack of game time. Most of his appearances have come from the bench. He's only started 2 games in the league this season. ESPN said back in January that we rejected several loan offers for van de Beek because we was reluctant to let him go. You know, we got him in a deal worth £40 million from Ajax last summer, and he's versatile. He can play in 3 different roles. But don't forget, he was out with injury for a while. Nemanja Matic, I think there's a good chance we'll offload him in the summer transfer window because he's not one of our first choice midfielders. Juan Mata, he's another one I think we're going to offload because he doesn't get an R11. It looks like Edison Cavani's leaving Manchester United as well in the summer transfer window, because Footballer Insider recently said that Cavani's willing to take a pay cut to go to Boca Juniors. He already has a verbal agreement with Boca Juniors. And a lot of United fans are saying that we need to sell Anthony Martial, because let's be honest, Anthony Martial has been out of form for the vast majority of this season. Alex Telles, we could also offload him. There's been talks of a swap deal between him and Nuno Mendes. Alex Telles has played nowhere near as much as I expected. When we got Telles last summer, I expected him to be our first choice left back immediately, but obviously hasn't happened. We got Telles in a deal worth £15.4 million from Port. He's done well in some of the games, though, he has been involved in. Don't forget, at one point he did have COVID. But yeah, there's a lot of players that will stay in the summer transfer window. And I think there's quite a few players at Man United that have got long-term futures. But Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, you know, he's been Manchester United manager now over 2 years. I'm reflecting now on he's been at the club. He has gained some managerial experience. He's tried a few different elements. He's learnt quite a bit on the job. You know, before he was with us, he was at Molde. He won a few Norwegian titles at Molde, but they're not a big club. And before he was at Molde, he was at Cardiff, and his record at Cardiff was absolutely disastrous. Don't forget, Ole managed Man United reserve team for a couple of years, so you watch some of this team grow and develop. I can assure Solskjaer is not the long-term manager for Manchester United. But even if we wanted to sack him now, wouldn't be able to anyway, because as far as I'm aware at the moment, no one's available. And plus, to be honest with you, if the club did decide to eventually sack him, it wouldn't really solve anything. As you all know, Solskjaer's agreed a new 3-year contract worth £30 million. It's likely to be 2 years with an option of an extra one. I presume a lot of United fans disagree with us giving him a new contract. You know, does he deserve a new contract? In some aspects, yeah. In some aspects, no. He's into the final year of his current 3-year contract. This is Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's second full season at the club. And I did say, you know, this season was always going to be a big season for him. But I've got to say, Ole is our best manager since Ferguson, and he's our fourth permanent manager since Ferguson. So yeah, I'll be doing some more videos later on. I'll be giving you obviously my reaction to Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's press conference ahead of this game against Granada. So, and there'll be another video also coming up. So anyway guys, that's everything to update you for today. Drop your comments, likes below on the channel. If you do, consider subscribing as always, and take care. God bless. See you all again very, very soon. Thanks for watching.